I am. My name is Stanley Maroney. Just want to welcome you here this morning to our worship. Just a couple of reminders. Wednesday meal this week is cooked out hamburgers. The men of the church are going to cook hamburgers for Wednesday night service. And we'll also do hot dogs with that. Remember to sign up for the Red Cross Blood Drive. It's on February the 22nd. There is a link to register on the church website. If you forget to do it today, you go to church website and register as well. Please pick up your 2021 donation statements in the church lobby. I know that if you haven't picked them up here in a couple of weeks, they will mail them out. We're trying not to mail those out, so if you can, stop by and pick those up in the church lobby. There will be a bridal shower for Madeline Hood and Mitchell Johnson on Saturday, February the 15th. It's from 10 o'clock to 11:30. And it'll be here at the church. We appreciate your faithfulness in making use of the donation plates. Our offering plates are at each of the doorways as you go out. We appreciate you making use of those as you leave today. And then I'm going to turn this over to Rhonda Dahlin. That was with TMS. She did the Activate class that we held here yesterday, and I'm going to turn it over for her for ministry moment.
Thank you. Good morning. It's so nice to be with y'all this weekend. Again, my name is Rhonda Dahlin, and I'm with TMS Global. TMS stands for Train, Mobilize, Serve. And really, we are passionate about one thing in our organization, and that is helping people join Jesus on his mission. We do that through sending missionaries around the world. We have about 140 missionaries that serve in 30 different countries. And we also do that by coming alongside churches with resourcing, training, and coaching. And that's why I got to join y'all this weekend for our Activate workshop. It was a great time. We had 35 people here, really great discussions and good ideas that were coming forth. Matthew 9 tells the story of Jesus, and he's with his disciples, and it says that Jesus is proclaiming the good news, sharing the gospel, healing the sick, and throwing out demons. And then it's very interesting. It says he stops and he looks and he has compassion on the crowd. He says, because they are hopeless, like sheep without a shepherd. And then he turns to his disciples and he says, look at this harvest. The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. So pray to the Lord of the harvest that he would raise up the workers. And then interestingly, in Matthew 10, right after that, he sends his disciples out on mission. And I love to see that progression, because Jesus sees the needs of the crowds. He looks at how the world is. He points to the disciples and says, do you see what's going on? Look at the needs of this world. And then he says, let's pray for workers to join me on this mission, and then he sends people out to do something. So that's what we talked about yesterday. We talked about the needs of the world. There's 7.9 billion people on this planet, which is kind of a crazy number to think about. About a third of the population of this planet says that they are Christians. About a third of the population has had access to the gospel, but they have chosen not to become a Christian. And a full third of this planet, I think it's 2.5 billion people, have never even heard of who Jesus is. If you would say the name of Jesus, they'd say, who is that? So a full third of this world doesn't even have access to the gospel. And so yesterday, we got to talk about what does it look like to be intentionally on mission around the world and right here in your own backyard. And there were some amazing ideas. And so thank you for letting me join y'all this weekend. Pastor Mark, I know it's a precious invitation to be invited into a church to speak about missions, but I'm so excited to see you guys have such a strong tradition and heritage of missions, and I'm excited to see what God is going to continue to do through you and as you birth a fresh vision for missions, because we have this grand invitation from the creator of the universe to help him do his work in this world. And when we step into that, it's a pretty amazing thing. So thank you.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Let's stand as we continue our worship together in song. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with rolling thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear. You've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the broken a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. I sing for all that you've done for me.
Speak their joy.
and every tear be dry. We're marching through Emmanuel's ground. We're marching through Emmanuel's ground to fairer worlds on high, to fairer worlds on high. We're marching to Zion, beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, that beautiful city of God. We're marching to Zion, marching upward to Zion, that beautiful city of God.
Amen. You may be seated.
Our scripture today comes from Psalm 19. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day they pour forth speech. Night after night they reveal knowledge. They have no speech. They use no words. No sound is heard from them. Yet their voice goes out into all the earth. Their voice, words, to the ends of the world. In the heavens God has pitched a tent for the sun. It is like a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, like a champion rejoicing to run his course. It rises at one end of the heavens and makes its circuit to the other. Nothing is deprived of its warmth. The law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The decrees of the Lord are firm, and all of them are righteous. They are more precious than gold, than much pure gold. They are sweeter than honey from the honeycomb. By them your servant is warned. In keeping them there is great reward. But who can discern their own errors? Forgive my hidden faults. Keep your servant also from willful sins. May they not rule over me. Then I will be blameless, innocent of great transgression. May these words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing to your sight, Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Let us pray. Thank you, Lord, for these words of wisdom. Watch over us, protect us, keep us safe from day to day. Help us to go out and be your servants and be your witnesses. In God's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Would you stand and sing with us, please?
Are you past the point of weary? Is your burden weighing heavy? Is it all too much to carry? And let me tell you about my Jesus. Do you feel that empty feeling? 'Cause shame's done all its stealing, and you're desperate for some healing. Let me tell you about my Jesus.
He makes a way where there ain't no way, rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that he can save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and his grace is free. And the good news is I know that he can do for you what he's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Amen.
Who can wipe away the tears, broken dreams and wasted years, until the past to disappear? Oh, let me tell you about my Jesus and all the wrong turns that you would go and undo if you could. Who can work it all for your good? Let me tell you about my Jesus.
He makes a way where there ain't no way, rises up from
cross to Calvary, pay the price for all my guilty. Who would care that much about me? But let me tell you about my Jesus. Oh,
He makes a way where there ain't no way, rises up from an empty grave. Ain't no sinner that He can't save. Let me tell you about my Jesus. His love is strong and His grace is free. And the good news is I know that He can do for you what He's done for me. Let me tell you about my Jesus. Let my Jesus change your life. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
Father God, We thank you for your presence here with us this morning. Pray that you be with Brother Mark as he comes to share the word. May it be your words and not his. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
How blessed are we today to be here with each other? Isn't it a great day to be here? I feel so blessed, and I want to talk to you today about being present in the moment and the today, and I want to give you a great example of not being present in the moment, by the way. So yesterday, we gathered here to listen to Rhonda and hear about Activate and TMS and try to find a stronger path forward with our mission, our outreach, our evangelism, and be better, more like Christ. And more reaching out than in here and stuck, okay? And on the way here, I realized I had to pay $5 for the book, right? So I stop at a gas station, and I'm just not really in the present moment, right? You know the Grubhub where McDonald's is in Southside? So I stop at the Grubhub, you know, to go to the ATM and get some money so I could pay for the book. And I am just not in the present moment. I'm thinking about what I just left the house thinking. I'm thinking about what's gonna happen when I get there. You know, I'm thinking about all those things. So I pull up into the gas station. I pull up into a parking lot. I jump out of the car and pull out my ATM card. I go to the ATM, and I shove it in the thing. And all of a sudden, all the people from McDonald's are looking across where the windows are, banging on the windows, looking at me and pointing. And I'm like, what in the heck did I do now? You know, I'm not in the moment. I look out. My car is rolling towards the pumps. I forgot to put my emergency brake on. Right? I'm not in the moment. Now I am in the moment. I'm running out the door, and I go to grab the handle, you know, get in and hit the emergency brake, lock the car door. Shoot, man, I'm thinking, this thing is going to crash into the pump. The whole thing's going to blow up. I look over, you know, people are lined up in the windows watching this. I'm surprised it hasn't blown up on Facebook. Well, anyways, I realize that I drive a Fiat. And really, all I have to do is stand behind it and push, and it'll stop rolling. You know? Just, I was not in the present moment. I was so busy thinking about past things and future things that I didn't think to pull my emergency brake when I pulled up into that parking spot. In matters of spirit, we can sometimes get lost in the past or in the future. It's easy for us to do this. It's only in the present that we actually encounter God. It's only in this moment when His Spirit falls on you now that you experience God. And here we are experiencing Him this morning. And I know we pray several times in the morning, but I got to tell you, our prayer life has got to get stronger. Okay? We have to be praying together about the exact same thing all the time. And so you always hear a prayer when we get started, another prayer just before we get going in. And right now, you know what I want to do? I want to pray. That's right. So if you would, bow your heads and join your hearts with me. Heavenly Father, we come before you today. We're not asking you for anything this morning. But what we want to do is just humbly give you thanks for all that you've done for us, the things we've seen, the things we haven't seen, the things we don't even know about. We appreciate you, Heavenly Father, for sending your Son to die on that old rugged cross just to redeem our sins. Your love was so evident in that moment for us, and we're thankful. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for enduring so much pain and suffering for our salvation. We give you thanks for giving us and our family and our loved ones health and strength, Lord. Thank you for your unconditional, undying, never-ending, endless love that graces us each and every day of our lives. You are the Redeemer, and we also want to give you thanks for waking us up on this glorious day. We thank you for your protection, not only over ourselves, but for all those that we love as well. We thank you for health and strength and grace and forgiveness and peace and joy, and for loving us unconditionally. for never failing us, Lord. We ask this morning that you lead us, Lord, today, so that whatever we do today in this present moment, we do it in your name, in the most powerful and present name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. And we lift this prayer up this morning in your name, Lord. May it be so. Amen. So somebody asked me the other day, what translation are you using? Because you notice in my translation there are descriptive words, things that say a little bit more so you can understand the context and the meaning. I use an amplified version, just in case you were wondering, so that I can get that context and meaning. And usually it's during the difficult translations where they pull it from the Greek or the Hebrew and give you the entirety of the meaning. So, in case you're wondering, amplified, if you'd like to find it. So this morning, Luke 4, 14 through 21 is what I'd like to read for you. Then Jesus went back to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and the news about him spread throughout the entire region. And he began teaching in their synagogue and was praised and glorified and honored by all. So he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And as was his custom, he entered the synagogue on the Sabbath and stood up to read. The scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me." That is the anointing. And it's anointing me to preach the good news to the poor. He has sent me to announce the release or the pardon and forgiveness to the captives, and the recovery of sight to the blind, to set free those who are oppressed, downtrodden, bruised, and crushed by tragedy, to proclaim the favorable year of the Lord, the day when salvation and the favor of God abound greatly. Then he rolled up the scroll, having stopped in the middle of a verse, gave it back to the attendant and sat down to teach. And the eyes of all those in the synagogue were attentively fixed on him. He began speaking to them. "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing and in your presence." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You'd think that the Son of God would have been better received in his own hometown. But Jesus is preaching at the synagogue in Nazareth. It's pretty much a bust. I mean, he could hardly do anything in the city. There he is, fresh from his successful battle with the devil. The tempter threw everything they had at him back there in the wilderness. He offers him power, he offers him fame, he offers him wealth. And Jesus resisted all of these offers. At the end of the day, a tempter, he slunk off in shame, waiting for what Luke calls an opportune time in 4:13. Now, Jesus on the way visited a few other communities before he got to Nazareth, and he was a sensation, but not so in his own hometown. His reputation had preceded him even, but still, in Nazareth, the headline should have been, "Hometown boy makes good," you know, right? Any of us would have done that. We would have been proud of him, right? But not so for Jesus' hometown. His debut is quite the opposite. I don't know, maybe it was the sermon that he preached. You know, sometimes when I preach a sermon, I get in a lot of trouble. You know, I'd step on some serious toes. By the way, I want you to really gird your loins this morning, okay? Because I'm telling you, this stomped all over my toes. My feet are sore. Just writing it was painful. And when I get along with it, you'll see exactly what I mean. The way Luke tells the story, Jesus stands up in the synagogue and he opens the scroll of the prophet Isaiah and he begins to read. "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim the release to the captives and the recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." But then Jesus does something really unexpected, especially in the context. Generally, he would read through the whole thing, get to the end of it. He stops in the middle. That's all he's got to say about that. He closes the scroll. He takes his seat. That doesn't mean he's finished. During that time, it was normal for the rabbi to sit down. And most of the time, everybody else would stay standing and listen to him, you know? So in his preferred position, sitting down, he begins to teach the scripture. He starts a sermon by saying, "Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." Today, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing. And now, that's where the reading ends for today. And I'm going to reserve the rest of Jesus' sermon and its outcome for next week's gospel reading. But I do want to tell you one thing about it. I'll share this one thing. We learn that the congregation turns against him abruptly. They don't like what he has to say. Right? Now, let's expound on that this morning. The stopping point in Jesus' statement that today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing. Let's talk about that for a minute. Today. Let's talk about today. Today. Now, it could be that the messianic implications of Jesus' statement eventually raises the crowd's hackles. But maybe it's that very first word Jesus uses. The very first one. Today. That could have been the thing that threw them. Today can be a mighty intimidating word. Especially when we're talking about the intervention of God in our world, making requests, proclaiming expectations on us. If I said, "Today, I want you to do this and that, and I'm expecting it to be done today," your hackles might get up a little bit too. You might think, "Well, I got some other things planned for today." Right? Maybe that's what threw them. Especially, you know, talking about God. It's easier to talk about God's action if we're talking about it maybe in the distant past. This is what God did way back then. Or it's even easier to talk about it if we're talking about the future. This is what God is going to do in the future, right? It's easier to talk in terms of past and future sometimes. Either one of the options, past or future, would be more comfortable than talking about the present today. And no doubt the people of Nazareth, they loved their heritage, right? They took pride in who they were. When we talk about the past, they were God's chosen people after all, right? So they have great pride in their heritage, their past, you know? They were God's chosen people, and they had ancestors.com. If they had that in that time, those people from Nazareth, they've been researching everything, you know, downloading pages of birth and death records to prove their proud heritage through Moses and on to Adam and Eve, you know, so that they could prove who they were, the great people that they were. It's like this man. I read this story about this man. He comes to the library in Baltimore, Maryland, where the Historical Society is, and he announces to the clerk there that he has finished his family tree, right? So he pulls out this document. It's elegant. He purchased it from some place. It was hand-lettered, colored with calligraphy pens, you know? It looked like the perfect document, patents of my who I am and where I've come from. Moving backward through time, it listed a pair of Maryland ancestors, one after another, until the family line jumped the ocean back to Europe. And there it prospered for many more generations past, and eventually it made its way back to the Middle East. And at some point, it intersected with the biblical genealogies, and what do you know? It ended up right with Adam and Eve. Right? The librarian, she just didn't have the heart to tell the guy he'd blown a whole lot of money on nothing. You know, that this is probably not a good genealogy, it's probably a junk one. For him, it was all about the past. It was all about what happened that made me the the person I am today, even if it really didn't have anything to do with me. Because let's face it, we don't always follow our father's footsteps or our mother's footsteps, do we? Some do, but most of us don't. For him, it was all about the past, though. He could have been sleeping in his car in a ditch on a back road, and that's all he had. But for him, everything was fine as long as he had a certificate verifying that he had the blood of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in him, right? And it was running through his veins, and he was a bona fide VIP chosen person, right? Which I lean on sometimes, by the way. I have faith that I'm his and he's mine. There's nothing wrong with that. I do lean on it. But I don't lean on my father's faith or my grandfather's faith. I lean on my present faith, what I believe today for me. The seductive lure of the past, it's not just in families. Guess where else it shows up? Churches. That's exactly where it shows up, isn't it? Have you heard it? We were joking about moving a piano the other day. That takes an act of everybody in the body of Christ in about 10 years to actually move it 2 or 3 inches, you know. Right? Sometimes it could be that way. They can sometimes become fixated on the glorious past. Sometimes it's remembering when they had a full Sunday school class. Or, you know, the sanctuary was bursting at the seams. We remember when there weren't any sports events on Sunday and everybody just came to church, you know. There weren't leagues. Yeah. And sometimes we do it like this. We say, if we could just figure out that right formula, we can bring back the glory of the old days and everything would be just fine, right? Yes, I know we're not the only church that sometimes thinks that way. I've served a few in my time. Now, I read somewhere that nostalgia is a file that removes the rough edges from the good old days. And it is that when we lose people in our lives, generally, we lose all those bad memories and we remember all the good ones, which is a good thing. Nothing bad with that. Memories that fixate on the glories of the past are highly selective for all of us. That's the truth of the matter. They cheerfully take the good and conveniently forget the bad, you know. Yeah. No doubt, there were some of that selective remembering going on in Nazareth when Jesus was preaching that day, especially when he said, today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing. There's the past, and sometimes we get caught in it. We get so caught in it that we forget to put the emergency brake on, you know, and realize here we are right now in this moment, right? But equally as seductive can be the future, especially in matters of faith. We focus on the day to come when all things will be made new. That too can be a way of escaping the demands of living in this present moment, of doing what's necessary today, right now, right? It can easily do that to us. There was a character that Charles Dickens created. It was David Copperfield. And in the book, in the novel, there was a man called Mr. Micawber. The circumstances of his life are not at all wonderful. But this guy and his wife are always living hand to mouth, but it doesn't bother Mr. Micawber at all. He's an eternal optimist. They called me Pollyannish, the psychologist did when I started in my trek down the clergy road. Pollyannish meaning, you know, everything's going to be okay, it'll all work out. Well, I am to an extent, but I'm also pragmatic, and a realist, you know, those things pop up too. He has only the vaguest idea of plans to better whatever condition he's living in. And the plans he does have are focused on a singular conviction that, in his words, something will turn up. It'll be okay, right? I want you to think about how many times you've heard those words in a committee meeting. How many times you've heard those words in life. Something will turn up. It'll be okay. God's got this, right? What's interesting is God's got this by moving in your life so that you'll do what his will is, and that's how he's got it. A lot of times he's asking us to do something, and we're going, hey, God's got it, but we aren't doing it. It's our responsibility. Something will turn up. McCowder's the sort of person who, when asked what sort of investment he has for the future, he tearfully answers lottery tickets. Not necessarily the answer that's going to, you know, project a real stable future. I'm pretty sure if I said lottery tickets, that wouldn't have worked. No, okay. If there's some possibility, however slight, of financial windfall, that hope, without any present effort, is enough to sustain him. That's the type of guy he is. Yeah. However, in the synagogue in Nazareth, Jesus is fixed neither on the past nor on the future. Jesus is fixated on the present. Today, this scripture is fulfilled. Not yesterday, not tomorrow, but today. Maybe it was Jesus' focus on the present that caused his neighbors to turn against him. You know? His fellow Nazarenes weren't interested in seeing a religious revival that would raise difficult questions like, what's God calling us to do in the here and now? What's God calling us to do in the here and now? Not based on the past 2 years, not based on what could happen in the future, today, what's God calling us to do? Not long ago, some of us were making some New Year's resolutions, right? The track record for those is terrible. Let's just face it, we make them, hardly ever get to them. All New Year's resolutions are almost entirely about the future. You know, they're future-oriented. It's easy shortly before the ball drops in Times Square to promise ourselves, I'm going to lose the weight, I'm going to quit smoking, I'm going to get my finances in order. It's so easy to look to the future and enjoy that harmless fantasy that declares, this year, I'm going to actually do it. I'm going to make it happen. I'm still working on that weight loss thing. I go up, I go down, I go up, I go down. I'll get there. But what if New Year's resolutions were different? What if they weren't so future-oriented? Rather than resolving, this year I'm going to change, what if we were to say, right now, today, we're going to change? What if we were to say, right now, we're going to make the change? We're going to do it. It's like saying this. On January 23rd, Christ Central Church is changing the way that they do ministries of mission, outreach, and evangelism. Today, we're going to start that change. And we're going to continue it every day from this point on. Or like saying, today we are going to change the financial future and the legacy of Christ Central Church. Today we're going to do it. We're not waiting for tomorrow. Today. What if we were to think in those terms? It takes that kind of determined focus on the present to bring about real change in any organization, in any family, in any life. It takes that kind of determination. Most resolutions that succeed have an element of the present in them, not just the future. They may begin life as a New Year's resolution, but they don't stay there for very long. Because when January 2nd rolls around, they transform themselves into a today resolution. And they remain so for each day that follows after that. Today, today. It used to be I prayed haphazardly. Now I don't do that. I wake up in the morning, I go to my computer, I pull up my list of prayer people, first thing I do. Because I know today I need to pray. Every single day. That's my prayer life. Perhaps what we're really scared of, or really scared the Nazarenes, was the prospect that God was present and active in their midst. He was there. Then, now. As Hebrews says, it is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. It's fearful because God doesn't enter our lives just to become ornamental furniture. When God enters our lives, it's because he wants more. He's going to hang around, not in some symbolic way like the proverbial Bible on the coffee table that never gets opened. Not like that. No. God enters our lives to transform them. To change them into something more. Something more of what he sees our potential to be. Something more. And that, it's never easy. It's never comfortable. And it's never instantaneous. It takes time. It takes effort. It takes patience. It takes faith. It takes prayer. It takes communication with God. It takes communication in the body of Christ, Christian conferencing, to move forward in a healthy manner. My hope for us is that we'll discover the sort of spiritual practice described by Frederick Buchner, who defines the word today as follows. It is a moment of light surrounded on all sides by darkness and oblivion. In the entire history of the universe, let alone in your own history, there has never been another just like it, and there will never be another just like it again. It is the point to which all our yesterdays have been leading since the hours of our birth. It is the point from which all your tomorrows will proceed until the hour of your death. If you were aware of how precious it is, you could hardly live through it. Unless you are aware of how precious it is, you can hardly be said to be living at all. There's power in those words, isn't there? Yes, there is. This is the day that the Lord has made. As the psalm says, let us rejoice and be glad in it. Today, present. The greatest saints and spiritual sages are people who have mastered the knack of intentionally living in the present. Right? With just that sort of awareness. Today, may you follow their example. Today, may you be able to raise the glad shout, this is the day the Lord has made, and really, truly mean it. Really, truly mean it. May that be so. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, thank you for taking the time. Let's pray together as the band comes back up. Holy Father, we are thankful for today. Help us be present in the moment. May we start to see where you are actively working and get involved in it, Lord. Help us see that. Help us see your Jesus moving through the crowd. Help us see your Spirit pointing directions. Help us see those things this morning, Lord. May that be so in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. May we stand, please.
Surely
the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel His mighty power and His grace. I can hear the brush of angels' wings. I see glory on each face. Of the Lord is in this place. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel His mighty power and His grace. I can hear the brush of angels' wings. The Lord is in this place. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place. I can feel His mighty power and His grace. I can hear of angels' wings. I see glory on each face. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place.
Do you please receive this benediction? You know, this is what I pray for you today. I was listening to the song And yes, the presence of the Lord surrounds us. It engulfs us. But it also indwells us. It is in each one of you, and the glory of His presence I can see in your faces easily because He is in you. What I pray this morning is that you realize He is in you, that He goes with you out the door. Not only is He before you and behind you, but He is with you in this present moment. May you feel that, embrace it, and share it with others this morning. May that be so in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace.
Amen. Folks, if you can give me a hand putting stuff up, next week's traditional service. Jim, you can leave the drums there. We don't need to move them. No. I just didn't feel comfortable yet. Next one we will. But I'm just a little, I was afraid we'd have too many that were apprehensive and wouldn't participate anyway. So we're going to wait till next time. I'm doing the choir.